wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men.
Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost a way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost a way.
You are
you find us,
Happy Easter, Four Corners. Would you go ahead and stand as we worship? We sing together. Come on. Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope and no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested, my life began. Ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet, my fear rose to dance. When death was arrested, my life began. We sing, oh, your grace, come on. Oh, your grace, so free, washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with the air. Release my chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom faithfully. So my dad, and he called me his friend. When death was arrested, my life began. We say, oh, your grace, so free, washes over me. You have made your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new, now life begins with the air. Yes, it does. Our Savior displayed on a criminal's cross. Darkness rejoices, so heaven at last. Hey, come on. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. Oh, that's when death was arrested and my life began. That's when death was arrested and my life began. Over me, you have made me new. Now life begins with the end. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Now life begins with the end. Of all the redeemed, yes, we're free, free forever, amen. When death was arrested, my life began. Oh, we're free, free forever, and free. Come join the song of all the redeemed, yes, we're free, free forever, amen. When death was arrested, my life. My life began. That's when death was arrested in my life.
first service. Death was arrested.
Come on, we can be thankful that the reign of darkness has ended. Jesus is alive. He's in this room. The reign of darkness now has ended. In the kingdom of light, in the kingdom of light. Come on, we sing it together. Forever under your dominion, you're the king of my life, you're the king of my life. You reign above it all, you reign above it all, over the universe and over every heart. There is no higher name, we lift him high. Jesus, you reign above it all.
Come on.
Now on the cross the work was finished. God, you poured out your life just to give us new life. Now from the lips of the forgiven, we'll hear an anthem arise. Hey. Jesus, you're alive. Yeah. And you reign above it all. You reign above it all. Over the universe, over every heart, there is no higher name. Jesus, you reign above it all. So let all of heaven and the earth erupt in song. No higher name, Jesus, you reign above it all. Oh, you reign above it all. All the earth, you sent the darkness running out of an empty grave. It's empty now, seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. You said you sent the darkness running out of an empty grave. Come on, now seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. We sing it now. You sent the darkness running out of an empty grave. Now seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. Sent the darkness running out of an empty grave. Now seated alone in glory, thrown on the highest praise. You sent the darkness running out of an empty grave. Seated alone in glory, thrown on the highest praise. You sent the darkness running out of an you reign above it all. So let all of heaven and the earth erupt in song. We'll sing hallelujah to the everlasting one. There is no higher name. Jesus, you reign above it all. Above it all, you are holy, you are worthy, God. You reign above it all, you reign above it all. We sing it now. Over the universe and over every heart, there is no higher name. Jesus. Jesus, you reign. Come on, we lift our hands to him. And you reign above it all. You reign above it all. Yes, you do. Over the universe and over every heart, there is no higher name. Jesus, you reign. So let all of heaven, and let all of heaven and the earth erupt in song. We sing hallelujah to the everlasting one. There is no higher name. Amen. Jesus, you reign above it all. Oh, yeah. Then came the morning. Come on, we sing. That sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe.
Yes, it did.
Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me.
Now, it was the day of preparation, and the Sabbath was beginning. The woman and the women who had come with him from Galilee followed and saw the tomb, and his body was laid. Then they returned and prepared spices and ointments. And on the Sabbath day they rested according to the commandment. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking the spices that they had prepared. And they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body of our Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. And as they were frightened, and they bowed their faces to the ground, the men said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but he has risen." And he has risen indeed this morning. Let's sing that verse again.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Oh, Jesus, yours is the victory. Oh, we sing hallelujah.
Come on, we sing it together.
Oh, hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. And you have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah and hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. Oh, there's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope.
It's our living hope this morning. The grave is still empty.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
Come on, first service.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. Oh, I speak Jesus, your name.
Your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Yeah. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn light. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over fear and all anxiety, to every soul that captivated by depression. I speak Jesus.
Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness for every enemy. Come on, sing. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Oh,
shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name.
Jesus from the Head out to their small groups. Your leaders are going to meet you right in the back. For the rest of us, we're going to greet each other, say hello to someone around you, shake a hand, hug a neck. Let's do it. All right. Good morning. Happy Easter, Four Corners.
Happy
good to
Easter
see you.
To you. Hey, we're so glad that you're here. My name is Ben. This is Kate. And welcome to Four Corners Church. Kate, I grew up in a church where we would do a thing. A lot of folks here have probably done it too. Let's see if they know it. On Easter Sunday morning, I say to you, He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
There you go. He is risen indeed. Happy Easter to you, Kate.
Happy Easter.
What a great day to be in the Lord's house to celebrate the resurrected Christ. We have so many amazing things, but we don't want to take a lot of time away from our service to tell you all about it. So the primary way you can get that information is on your seat when you sat down. There was a little piece of paper that looks like this. It has all the amazing stuff for the rest of the year, many of them, not all of them, right there on the back so you can take this home with you. It's a gift to you today. And on the front, a little bit about a special offering we're doing. I'll tell you about later in just a few moments. Kate?
Yeah.
Tell everybody some of the cool stuff we have going on today.
So many great things. So first off, if you are new here, if it's your first day at Four Corners Church, you have picked an amazing day to be at Four Corners. Easter around here, it's honestly probably our favorite day, the greatest day in history. So thank you for joining us. We have a way for you to connect today, and we're going to ask everybody, whether you've been around here for almost 20 years or it's your very first time right now, to pull out this Connect card. So we normally do the QR code, and if you've been around here for a while, we've been doing that. But we're asking every single person right now to pull this out, and we're going to fill this out old school style, paper and pen, because things change. People move. Phone numbers change. Jobs change. So we are trying to, while we have everybody in the house, to update our database. So if you could please fill out all this information. If you're a first-time guest, there's a place there that you can check, and we want to send you some coupons for free Chick-fil-A, and it'll be all in there. And then anything you're interested in, you can check there. And here in a few minutes when the offering buckets go around, you can just drop this in here in the buckets. And then if you miss that and you're still filling it out, as you leave, there's some receptacles in the back that are black that you can drop this in as well.
Kate, the primary way we make budget around here is we take all of your information and we sell it to our cousins over in Nigeria. He's a prince. He'll probably be in touch with you about some money he wants to give you. No, it's all safe and secure. We're not going to hound you. We're not going to show up at your house. But if you're a regular attender, please, it's important that we keep our database up to date. Please just go ahead and fill that out, and in a moment drop it in the offering bucket. And if you're our guest, your gift to us today is this card.
Yeah, absolutely. I would love to talk a little bit about the Easter offering and what's going on with that, and then what we are celebrating today with Easter offering.
Sure. So if you're our guest around here, you should know that you're around some incredibly generous people. And so every year at Christmas and Easter, we raise money to make a difference. We make a difference here in our church, we make a difference locally near in our community, and then we make a difference all the way around the world. And so at Easter, all the stuff that the money's going to is there on the card. You can read that. But two things I want to highlight very, very quickly is in just a few days, we're going to send some folks from our church down to our partner churches down in Cuba. We've sent over 50 people from this church now to Cuba.
Yeah.
And we have a group of churches down there that we are partnering with. And one of their primary meeting facilities needs a major electrical upgrade. And so our Easter offering is going to help pay for that. It's going to help pay for the equipment, sending the right people down to do this stuff. And we'd like for you to be a part of that. The other thing, Kate, that I'm just excited about is a big portion of our Easter offering is going to help students go to student camp this year. So many people in our church, myself included, our lives have been impacted by what happened when we were teenagers. And we believe that the gospel of God is so strong that it'll drive an anchor in a student's heart that no matter which way the winds of life blow, it can help hold them. And so if you give today to the Easter offering, it'll go to support those things. The way you do it is you just write Easter on a check or on the envelope, or if you do it online via the QR code or any of the other ways, you just select 4C Easter gift for this year. And so we have some folks in just a moment that are going to receive tithe and offering. Let's go ahead and have those folks come forward while you tell them a little bit more information.
Yeah, so what's really great, so there's student camp going on, and then we also have kids camp. So separate those two out. Kids camp is anyone that is like 3 years old up to fourth grade. Student camp is 5th through 12th grade. But right now, while the ushers are coming forward, I want you guys to take a look at this amazing recap video from our kids camp last year. Kids camp registration opens today. As you guys leave, there's a table out in the lobby. So for all the things we're going to talk about, kids camp, student camp, and then the few things we're going to talk about here in a minute, you can stop out at that table and get some more information. So throw your eyes to the screen for this.
So, Pastor Kate,
you
and your team lead this. We had about 200 kids last summer.
Yeah.
We're praying for 250.
Yeah.
And sign up for that begins
today.
They can use their QR code. They can also exit this building when our service is over this room and walk right to the left, right across the lobby to the corner of the lobby.
Yeah.
And there'll be a table there where you can sign up for kids camp. You can sign up for women's retreat. You can sign up for the men's retreat. And today we're opening up signups for men's retreat. By the way, we have a full roasted pig on the spit, the whole bit, guys. Our food is going to be so much better than the ladies' retreat.
Full on hog roast happening at men's retreat. Yeah.
There are some folks standing here who are ready to receive your offering. If you'd like to give to support the ministries of this church, it makes a huge difference. And if you want to give to our Easter offering, you can do there. If you're a guest, you don't have to give. If you want to, we'd certainly take your money and use it to further God's kingdom. For our folks who call this church home, let me give you some news. Our goal for our Easter offering is $45,000, and as of this morning, we're at $39,000. So, isn't that amazing?
That's amazing.
You're going to do great things for the kingdom of God. You're going to do great things to help people's lives change. You're literally going to feed our hungry neighbors. Thank you. All this money makes a dramatic difference. Let's pray, and then we'll receive our offering, and then we got a couple more things to tell you. So, God, we're grateful right now that you are alive. You are not dead. And we're grateful that you have blessed us. And so, Lord, as an act of our worship, we give back to you a portion of what you have blessed us with. God, I pray that you would take this money, you would multiply it, you would use it to make a profound difference here, near, and far, all the way in Cuba, all the way to our partner churches in India, all the way around the globe, everywhere the name of Jesus is being lifted up and people are coming together to do his work, to be his hands and feet. We pray you bless it all in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
And amen.
Amen.
So I did tell folks, Kate, that we are launching today the sign up for the men's retreat.
Yes.
They can also sign up for the ladies' retreat. Is there anything else that we need to tell them about
all
that stuff?
Yeah, maybe just the quick dates. So women's retreat is April 19th and 20th, and it's out at Connection Point Campground. And then men's retreat's at the same location, and it is May 10th and 11th. So they're just a couple weeks apart, but great things happening. Lots of good food, coffee, fellowship, prayer, worship. The guys will just be more manly.
In fact, we're calling it Act Like Men.
Yes.
And so we're going to have, you know, knives and axes and guns and that sort of thing.
Just going to grunt all weekend.
Yeah, grunt all weekend. And then somewhere in there, we're going to have some worship. We're going to do, we're going to learn some stuff from Scripture about what God calls men, the dignity and the honor to which He calls men to live as they're single or as they're married, to press into all that God has for them. It's going to be absolutely amazing. Kate, is there any final thing that we should tell folks today?
No, enjoy service. Happy Easter, you guys. So get ready. Pastor Ben's got an amazing message prepared. And if you have any questions at all about anything we talked about, come see us at the table after service.
My wife and I will be standing at the table over there where all the signups are. If you're a guest today, if you brought a guest, we'd love to meet you. Meet us over there after service. Grab a cake pop. Grab some cotton candy.
All kinds of green stuff. The green drink was like electric green.
It was amazing.
It's
I had
so
about
good.
12 cups of that this morning. So turn your eyes to the screen, please. You heard the scriptures earlier today, but very early in the morning, the ladies go to the tomb that they saw the body of Jesus placed in. There were Roman guards placed at the tomb to make sure that nobody could take the body. The authorities in charge were concerned about a revolt because of the popularity of the man they had just crucified. The governor of the area put a wax seal on the stone to make sure that had the stone been moved, the wax seal would be broken. One more way to secure that no shenanigans could happen at the burial site of Jesus. They didn't go to the tomb expecting it to be empty. They didn't go with faith profound and deep and intact. Even though they had heard Jesus say, kill this body and it'll rise again in 3 days. They'd heard that. But they didn't go believing that they would find an empty tomb and a resurrected Christ. The reason we know that is the ladies are carrying spices to anoint the body. And on Sunday morning, the first day of the week, at about dawn, the Bible tells us, they find the stone rolled away. And there are messengers there. And they say to them, why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, he is risen. And then go tell his disciples, and my favorite line in the whole story, and Peter, go tell his disciples that he has risen. The ladies scurry off, and they tell the disciples the story. The tomb is empty. He is not here. He's risen. And they're not certain what to think. I don't know what you think faith looks like in the New Testament among the heroes, among John and Peter and James and Thaddeus, the 12. I don't know what you think it looks like, but at the death, in the resurrection event over those days, that faith took an amazing journey. They were fully believing just a few days before. They were fully trusting. They had had a meal together with Jesus, and at that meal, they each affirmed their allegiance. No matter what happens to you, Jesus will stand by you. Right after that meal, it began to fall apart. One of the 12 who had been walking with Jesus, who had been doing the stuff, who had looked like, to some degree, he's all the way in, and he has a significant position in the organization of those early Jesus followers. He's the one who keeps the purse. Right after that meal, he goes out and he begins to conspire with the enemy how to reveal who Jesus is and when they could take him. There's Peter, not my favorite disciple in the Bible, because He's always putting his foot in his mouth, and he's rarely leading out with the right thing. He typically leads out with the wrong thing, and then kind of has to make up for it, and then does the right thing. I just love the humanity of this guy. There's Peter, who more than anybody else said, I will never deny you. And right after he speaks that, within just a few hours, three times he denies that he even knows who Jesus is. I've never even heard of him, he says, while he's cursing up a storm like only a fisherman his previous occupation could do. And then they all see him on the cross. One gospel writer tells us there's only one person left of the 12, John, the youngest of the disciple, there with Mary, the mother of Jesus. Everybody else is gone. And then the ladies follow him to the tomb where his body is laid. But on Easter Sunday morning, it's empty. And they go back and they tell the disciples, he's not there, he's risen. And he's going to go and meet you. He's going to see you. And they're skeptical. And with this very humble, somewhat emotionally for the disciples, shaky beginning, Christianity begins in earnest. And when I say Christianity, I'm not talking about an organization. I'm not talking about a church or a denomination. I'm not talking about a set of rules or even a set of beliefs, although all of those things have their place and they're wildly important. I'm talking about a group of people who are so radically committed to Jesus, and they believe something very, very unusual, that the Jesus that they had been living with and were eyewitnesses of his actions and had seen his teaching and his miracles, they literally believed he became fully dead. He did not swoon. He did not pass out. He didn't have the appearance of death, but he was still alive. He really fully died. They believed he literally was raised back to new life. And they put their trust in him at a level that they had never done before. They all had some faith. But after the resurrection, their faith takes full form. And when their faith in the death and resurrection of Jesus, that he really is the Son of God, that his work on the cross, as Jesus said, is finished, that the wrath of God was satisfied, that sins would be forgiven, that a new life would came, could come to everybody who would believe. When they put their faith and trust in that, it exponentially begin to change things for them, and through them begin to change things for other people. The year is somewhere around the year AD 33. They don't call it that yet. It's going to be called that later. They're not yet marking the calendar like we do BC before Christ and AD Anno Domini in the year of our Lord. They're not quite yet doing that. But by our calendar, it's about 33 AD. Rome is very much in charge. Because Rome is in charge, the little nation of Judea, where the Judeans are, or the Jews are, those who are the followers of Jesus, the Hebrews, all of them were early Christians, were Jewish people. Because Rome is in charge, they all have really two sources of authority to submit to: their religious leaders in their own culture, and the authority of Rome. And it seems like both authorities have conspired together, at least, to undo what they believe is the greatest news this world has ever heard, that there is a God who loves you, who sent his one and only Son to die in your place to appease the wrath of God so that you could have access to the Father as a son or as a daughter of the King, the greatest news this world has ever heard. But because Rome is in charge, because Rome is so large and so massive, because no army on earth can beat Rome, it's a little terrifying if you see Rome as your enemy. So this church, this group of Christians, it begins, and it begins to change things dramatically. In fact, in just the first few weeks after the death and resurrection of Jesus, the little group goes from about 12 to 30 huddled in an upper room to 120 gathered in the same room 50 days later. To the very next day, there's 3,000 people who have put their faith and trust in Jesus. You can read all of those stories in the book of Acts, chapter 1 and chapter 2. In just 50 days after the resurrection, 3,000 people have put their faith and trust in the resurrected Jesus. In fact, in the city where this upper room experience occurred, there are people gathering from all over the Roman Empire who have a Jewish background in Jerusalem. Among them, very likely, was a married couple by the name of Aquila and his wife Priscilla. Aquila and Priscilla. They're in Jerusalem celebrating the Feast of Pentecost, one of the high holy days of the Jewish faith. And on that day, it's very likely that they heard Peter preach the first Christian sermon. They're residents of Rome. They put their faith and trust in Jesus. And they leave Jerusalem after the Feast of Pentecost is over, and they go back to Rome, and they establish a little prayer meeting of Jewish people in their home, and they begin to talk about Jesus. And this little group of Jewish people in the city of Rome begin to come together and pray and read the scriptures in light of Jesus and begin to tell the stories that they had heard in Jerusalem about Jesus. And a little bitty group of faithful Jewish people put their faith in Jesus and become Christians and start a church in the city of Rome, the power center of the universe at the time. I mean, the Roman Empire is in full swing right now. It is at its zenith. It's at its power, most powerful. The boundaries of Rome are ever expanding. And for the next few decades, Rome is going to be unstoppable. This is the world in which your New Testament occurs. Under the banner of Roman authority and a group of huddled together believers proclaiming that Jesus was dead, but he's alive. And if you'll put your trust in him, it will change everything in your life and it'll change everything through your life. About 10 years later, there's a man on his way with the authority of Rome, but more importantly, in his situation, with the authority of his Jewish religion. He's on his way to find one of these little groups of Christians that are huddled together in a house praying and preaching about Jesus, and he's going to bring them trouble. The conflict that took its form with the death of Jesus is still moving forward. They thought if they killed him, it'd be over, but it was far from over. And so it's still moving forward. And so these Sadducees and the Pharisees and the Zealots in the Jewish faith are really worried that so many of their converts are kind of still Jewish, but now they trust in Jesus as God, which creates major theological problems for the Jewish people. That God could have a son, that Jesus could in fact be God like he claimed he was in the New Testament. And these people, in droves, by the hundreds, by the thousands, within 10 years, you're probably looking at about 150,000 Christian converts. And churches springing up in all the cities of the empire. And one Jewish boy who had had an incredible beginning. He was born in the city of Tarsus in modern eastern Turkey. But his family was wealthy. They had earned Roman citizenship. So they had the ability to send him to the best schools. They send him to Jerusalem as a young man, as a teenager, to study at the feet of the greatest Jewish scholar of the day, Gamaliel. And that would be equivalent to like getting your kid into Harvard or Yale. They send him to study at the feet of Gamaliel, and he is a bright student. He speaks multiple languages. He speaks Aramaic, the kind of common language of his people. He can read Hebrew. The ancient language of his people. He can speak Greek, and probably because he's Roman and so well-learned, he probably can handle Latin as well. His name is Saul. Saul from Tarsus. And about 10 years after the death and resurrection of Jesus, with 100, 150,000 believers and 25, 30, 50 house churches gathered around, Paul sets out like a good, faithful Jewish boy to make it difficult for people to hear the message of Jesus, to turn to Jesus, to trust Jesus, to just make it hard. And he has the authority of his Jewish leaders behind him. And he has all the clout, and he has money, and he is on the rise in the ranks of the Jewish echelon. He's up and to the right on his career. And one day, while he's walking on a road with a group of people, to tell Christians to stop it. Stop talking about Jesus. Your theology is wrong. You don't understand God. It doesn't fit the paradigm. Something profound happens to him. He tells the story four times in the Bible. Three times in the book of Acts it's recorded. One time in the letter he writes to the church at Galatia, he tells the story of what happened to him on that fateful day. He's just on his way, and all of a sudden, he's blinded by this incredible light. It's not just him. Everybody around him is stunned, and then there's a voice that sounds like thunder. He hears it in his language. Everybody else hears like a rolling thunder. And here's what he hears. Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? He has no idea. He has no context for this. It's such a profound event that, again, he tells it four different times in the New Testament. He responds to the voice, "Who are you?" And acknowledging that whoever's doing this, whatever's going on, has supreme power over him in the moment. "Who are you, Lord?" Now, this is not like Lord Jesus Christ, I submit. It's like, "Lord, don't hurt me. You have power. I'm down here. You're clearly up there." It's a statement of, "Who are you, Lord?" And the voice speaks back, "I'm Jesus." And in that moment, Paul's life is about to change. The voice says to him, Saul, whose name has changed to Paul at this moment, "Saul, quit kicking. Quit kicking. It's your leg is caught like in a bear trap, and your kicking is just making it worse. It's just biting it. Give up. I got you." And in that moment, Saul becomes a Christian, and his name is changed to Paul. He has this encounter with the resurrected Christ that leaves him forever changed. He tells the story four times. In another place in the Bible, I just want to read to you. I don't have it for the notes for you on the screen. I just want you to hear the words of Paul of Tarsus, whose name was Saul of Tarsus. I just want you to hear his words for a minute. Outside of the gospel writers and then the book of Acts, so Luke, who writes Luke and Acts, 1 Corinthians 15, Paul's letter to the Corinthian church, a major city in the Empire of Rome, chapter 15, he tells the story of the resurrection and how the story of the resurrection impacted his life and changed him forever. 1 Corinthians 15, Paul writes, he says, "Now I make known to you, brothers, the gospel which I proclaim to you, which you have also received, in which you stand, by which you are also being saved, if you hold fast to the message I proclaim to you, unless you believed to no purpose. For I pass on to you as of first importance," the most important thing, "what I also received." And here's what the most important thing is: "that Christ died for your sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised up on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas." Now, Cephas is Peter. Cephas is Aramaic for rock. Peter is Greek for rock. So he appeared to the rock, Peter, and then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at once, the majority of whom remain until this day. They're eyewitnesses. They're still alive. You can go talk to them. Some of them have died. They've fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, and then to all the apostles. And last of all, I love this line, he says, "as it were to one born at the wrong time, he appeared also to me." He's like, Paul's like, "I think I was born in the wrong time. Like, he had to come to me late. Like, I should have been one of the 12, maybe. I don't know. So had I been born early, I'd have probably been one of the 12. I was born late, so he had to come to me last of all." He says, but he appeared to me also, "for I am the least of the apostles, not worthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am." Now listen to this last line, because this is a line for somebody here today. "And his grace to me has not been in vain." Paul says, "I just was what I was. I was from Tarsus, trained at the feet of Gamaliel, a Roman citizen," which was very special to be Jewish and a Roman citizen, "brought to the best schools, in and out of Jerusalem my whole life for all the holy days, faithful to persecute people who don't stand faithfully in the faith of our forefathers. I just was what I was. But the grace of God came to me and changed everything." The resurrection of Jesus is the greatest event in human history. It changed everything. It changed everything. And an encounter with the resurrected Jesus is the greatest event in a man or woman's life. That's exactly what the Apostle Paul was trying to tell us in 1 Corinthians 15. The highest, most important thing, Jesus lived, he died, but he's not dead anymore. And you can have an encounter with him. I'm talking to a handful of folks online and a bunch of people in this room who've had an encounter with the resurrected Christ. It may not have looked like what happened to the women in the garden or even to Thomas when Jesus shows up in the room and says, put your hand in the holes in my hand, put your hand in my side where I was pierced. It may not have happened like Paul on a road with a bright, blinding light and a voice like thunder, but many people in this room, most of us I would imagine, have had an encounter with the resurrected Jesus, and it has changed everything. For the next few weeks in this church, we're going to dive deep into one of Paul's most important letters, this guy that we've been talking about, who had an encounter with the resurrected Jesus. We're going to dive into one of his most important letters written to that little group of believers in the city of Rome, the capital city, the imperial city. It's a very important city, obviously. And in that important city, there's a group of believers that Paul has not yet visited on sight. He knows some of their leaders. He's, over his travels, become acquainted with the business people, Priscilla and Aquila. And somehow in their travels, as they did the stuff, they've crossed paths multiple times, and they've developed a friendship. In fact, Priscilla and Aquila helped train Paul in what it is to be a disciple. They're part of his early footsteps. And they're part of that church at Rome for a season. And somewhere about what we would call AD 54, Paul writes a letter to this church in Rome that he didn't start, but he cares about. And in this letter, he's going to explain the Christian faith in such a profoundly important and uniquely simple level. It's going to be profound and significant. It's also going to be simple. And in about 16, we would call them chapters or divisions, this long letter, he's going to explain what it is to be a follower of Jesus, what it means, and how special it is, and how precious it is. So we thought it'd be a good day on Easter Sunday to launch into looking at what might be the most important letter outside of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, what might be the most important part of your New Testament. When you look at theologians over the last 2,000 years of church history, uniquely they give an inordinate amount of time to this one book. It's at the top of the list. It's so important. Its importance is noted in part by guys like some of you are fans, perhaps, of the theologian John Calvin. Some of you don't like him at all, and that's fine, too. That's welcome to Christianity. We argue about things. It's okay. But John Calvin says that in the book of Romans is all of the gospel. Now, he doesn't mean everything you need to know, but it's all kind of touched on in that book. Charles Wesley, kind of the other side, who starts the great Wesleyan movement, becomes the Methodist church around the globe, he speaks profoundly about the book of Romans and its impact on his conversion. Multiple people who were a little bit wishy-washy in their faith read the book of Romans with a humble and open heart and had their faith solidified. Multiple phrases in this book will jump out at you as you read its 16 chapters. The average person with average reading level can read this book in under 2 hours, no problem. Many of you in under 60 minutes if you just read it. But a lot of times you'll kind of read and stop and kind of want to back up, because while it is simple and profound, what it deals with is of such depth and has such broad-ranging implications. So I thought what we would do today is I'd get your feet wet just a little bit. But let me make it very, very real to you for just a moment, like it was made real to me just a couple of years ago. I studied this book a lot. A couple years ago, Jill and I had the great good fortune of spending a couple days in Rome. I don't say that to like brag. I don't have like a bunch of pictures. Look at my slideshow. But if you really want to know, go to my Facebook page. We bragged about it the whole time we were gone. So you can see how great our life was. And but there was a couple of moments while we were in Rome that deeply impacted me. One was when I visited this place. Would you show that picture up? Now, right now, it's a church. At the lower level of that church, you can see the phrase in Latin, Maritima, right? Today in English, we call it the Maritime Prison. It's a church built over what was an ancient Roman prison. In the time of Paul, somewhere in the 60s, during the reign of Nero, the emperor, Paul was put in what was the previous building on this site. Show them the next picture, if you don't mind. It was a prison, multiple levels to this prison. This is the actual cell that held not just Paul, but Peter. Two of the early most important leaders of the Christian church both ended up in Rome. Rome wasn't known for its prisons. If you committed a crime, you weren't put in prison for a long time. They killed you, cut off your hand, typically made you do hard labor. That's what their favorite thing is. Let's make you work for us. It's cheap labor. But if you had to be held for trial or held for a special event, especially if you were a little bit popular, they would isolate you from the crowd in a prison. And this is the most popular one, right near the Roman Forum. The Roman Forum is the seat where all of the special places are, the seat of its governance. It's, if you wanted to visit the high rent district in Rome, you went to the Forum. I want to show you a little bit more about this prison. If you don't mind, go to this next picture. This is an artist rendering. You see an upper prison and a lower prison. The lower prison at one point was a cistern catching the rainwater from the roof for drinking, but it was stopped by that in that process hundreds of years, actually before Paul and Peter are put in there. There's a little hole in the middle of the upper chamber, and in the bottom chamber, the only way in and out was through that hole. And at some point in Paul's journeys, after he has started 14 house churches, wrote letters to them after he left to see how they were doing and answer their questions. Many of those letters are contained for us in our New Testament. Paul was lowered through that hole from the upper chamber by rope into the lower hole while he awaited his sentencing. Now, you can't tell from these pictures, but the view, if he had had a window outside of this building, is magnificent. I captured just a little bit of it on the next picture, if you don't mind. Go ahead and throw that one up. This is the Roman Forum. The day that Jill and I were there, and you're looking at the road, kind of, if you were to follow it kind of back to the left this way, it would take you right up to that prison. If you had left the prison and walked down the road, you would pass the Temple of Tiberius. You would pass temples to Mars. There was one temple to Romulus, Romulus and Remus, the mythical founders of the city of Rome. There was government buildings, there were altars, there was an arch of triumph for one of the emperors at a major battle. And at the end of this road was Nero's circus, where he would do the chariot races. The most popular sport was NASCAR in Rome. It was the chariot races. And they would gather by the 100, 150,000 people at a time to watch chariot races. And they were brutal and vicious, and they loved it when an axle would break and the guy would go tumbling and the crowd would cheer. Just like you. Like, no, you don't want anybody to wreck, but you don't want anybody to get hurt. But when they wreck in NASCAR, it's kind of fun. It's kind of fun. So I know you should probably go to a different church because I do think that's a little bit fun. As long as they're not hurt, I said. As long as they're not hurt. It's kind of fun to see how those things happen. One day, at about 68, 69 AD, Nero's in power, and Nero and Christians don't get along. In his circus for sport, Nero would impale Christians on a pole. He'd light them on fire as sport to light his gardens at night while he entertained important people. It was a vicious, vicious time. Paul is put in the Maritime prison. I remember standing in that dark place thinking about the faithfulness of guys like Peter and Paul and the other disciples. And there came a day while he was there that he heard an order given to the guards above, get him out. And when they lifted him out, he knew that this wasn't an ordinary day. A couple of the biggest men he had ever seen would grab him by the arm, and they would walk him out of the upper chamber, down a couple steps, onto that road. He would walk past Tiberius's temple and Mars's temple and the Arch of Triumph and a few other things. He'd walk past all that, all the way over to Nero's circus. It would be a path that Peter had walked. He knew when that journey started, it would be his last day on earth. He had given his life. When you read his story in the Bible, he's stoned, he's whipped. He's whipped. And in that day, the custom was to whip somebody with this cat of nine tails, 39 lashes. The rumor was that 40 lashes you would die. So they would back off one. They didn't want you to die. His back bore the scars of being whipped repeatedly. He had been shipwrecked, bitten by a poisonous snake. Traveled hundreds of thousands of miles in the days before modern transportation. Gave everything he had for the care and the nurture of this little group of Christians who were following that man that he met on that road that day as he was traveling to the city of Damascus to persecute them. And now he's taking his final walk. And just outside the city walls, they would put him against a stone, and an assassin would lower an axe and sever his head from his body. There's a church that commemorates the spot now where that occurred. And there's a church that commemorates one of the stopping points along the journey where Nero's circus was, the exact spot that Peter died. I've often thought, if I could talk to Paul, like, what would I say to him? I think I'd say, hey, thank you for being faithful. Thank you for all the encouraging words. I mean, Paul, you wrote these letters. Did you know, Paul, when you wrote these letters, in my day, they're 2,000 years old, that they would have such practical insight about my faith, but not just my faith. Paul, your words written 2,000 years ago saved my marriage. When you talked about what it was for a man to be a godly man who follows Jesus, the words you wrote in the book of Ephesians to a group of people I've never met, when I read them, they softened my heart and literally saved my marriage. Paul, when you wrote those letters to Titus and to Timothy, they were two specific people living in a specific time. But Paul, when I read those letters as a young man, they called me to do something more than I would have naturally done. Paul, when you said to Timothy, don't let anybody look down on you because you're young. Paul, as a young man, when I read those letters, they pulled my heart in the right direction. I made different kinds of choices because of your faithfulness and your... Paul, did you have any idea at the day that Paul walks that final journey? There's no indicator that his work is going to outlast him. In fact, it looks like the greatest persecution, the greatest challenges of the Christian faith are happening at that exact moment. They've either just killed or are just about to kill Peter. We're not sure exactly what happens first, Peter or Paul. It looks like all the work he's done and all the beatings he suffered and all the personal strife, it looks like it could be coming to an end. And I'd like to just ask him, Paul, what was going through your mind on that day when those big Roman soldiers grabbed you one by each arm and began to walk you down that long road to your final step? I'd like to look him in the eye and tell him, thank you. Thank you for letting your experience with the resurrected Christ touch you so deeply that no matter how many challenges came your way, you stuck it out. Paul, you weren't fickle. You were faithful. Paul, thank you that as people even in the church lied about you and told stories on you that weren't true and tried to undermine your authority and say that you had no right to do anything, you dealt with them with grace and truth, but you persevered. Thank you for being faithful, because your faithfulness made a profound difference. I don't know in this imaginary conversation what he would say to me. But I think probably I get some hint of it in the passage we just read. Something to the effect of, here was the most important thing, Ben. Christ lived, Christ died, but he's not dead, and I met him. And it changed everything. What else would I do? It's the most important thing. Nothing else mattered. My comfort didn't matter. My security didn't matter. My status didn't matter. What other people said about me didn't matter. In fact, the only thing that mattered, what anchored me, was this encounter I had with the resurrected Christ. It changed everything. So what more would I give my life to? And what less would I give my life to? That was it. I'd like to tell Paul this, because I think it's funny and true. Hey, Paul, when you were walking down that road and you got to Nero's circus, that big arena where it all kind of went down for so many others, and you're so popular they wouldn't do it there, they took you a little bit further on to do you. When you got to that, Paul, did you know that today the largest church ever built stands on the exact site of Nero's circus? It's called St. Peter's. And every year, hundreds of thousands of visitors gather to the place where Peter was martyred for his faith, and they gather and they lift up the name of Jesus. And Paul, did you know that all around the world, these 14 house churches you started, people will read your letters to them? Like, people will stand up in front of crowds, and they'll open the book that has your letters, and they'll read your words? Paul, did you know that all around the world, in every language, in every tribe, people will name their kids Paul and Peter and James and John? Oh, and by the way, Paul, they'll name their dogs Caesar and Nero. Yeah. An encounter with the resurrected Christ will change everything. And it still does. It still does. I want to read for you the opening to his letter of the book of Romans, the first 6 verses. And there's one line particularly that grabbed my heart as a young man. It's a big reason why, honestly, I'm here. It was one of those things from the Word of God that still speaks in power. These letters written. I don't know that Paul had any idea that we'd be reading them today. I think he was just being obedient and faithful, and the Lord chose by his sovereignty to preserve them, to have them widely read, to have them gathered up. Romans chapter 1, verse 1. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scripture concerning his son, who was descended from David according to the flesh and was declared to be the Son of God in power according to the Spirit of holiness by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord. By the way, if you're keeping count and you're an English major, we're still in one sentence. Paul has these massive run-on sentences in the Greek. He's like, I got an idea, and I need a descriptive phrase. Here's another thought, and I need a dependent phrase. And here's another thought. About 12 adjectives would go good here. This is the way he does it. This is why he can feel a little difficult to read. But at its point, he's just saying, I was set apart for the gospel of God. And by the way, what is the gospel? That there was this man, Jesus, born in the line of David. But he's not just a man born in the line of David. He's set apart by the Spirit of God for a holy purpose. Verse 5. Through whom we have received grace and apostleship to bring about the obedience of faith for the sake of his name among all the nations. And then he says to those in Rome, including you who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. To all those in Rome who are loved by God and called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. It's the line there in verse 6. To all those in Rome, I wasn't in Rome. I was in college, wondering about what my life would be about and what I should do. I had an inkling and I had a lot of fear. I'd known since I was a little boy that Jesus had touched my life. I was 5 years old. I didn't fully understand it. My faith was young, but the God who grabbed hold of me when I was 5 was bigger than me. It was bigger than the journey I was about to go on and all the stuff of life that would come my way and all my good but mostly bad decisions. My God was bigger than all of that, and he gripped my heart when I was 5 years old. So here I am in college trying to figure out what I'm going to do, and I have a pretty good life plan. I'm going to be a fighter pilot because I had seen Top Gun and they get all the girls. That was my life goal right there. Fighter pilot was just a vehicle, a pathway to get all the girls. You see how this works? That's where I was headed. And then I got the scholarship given to me to go to a Christian college, which required a chapel service to go to, and where when classes opened, they were open with prayer, and I got an incredible education academically. I was stretched and pulled in so many ways. And yet, it all happened under this umbrella of Christian faith. And I was challenged in one of those classes to actually read the Bible. I had had the Bible read to me, and I'd read the Bible some, but I began to read the Bible, and I remember coming to this line, including you who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. And it hit me. I'm called to belong to Jesus Christ. There are a lot of other things that I might do with my life. I'd kind of given up the fighter pilot dream, and I'd kind of stepped into this, I'm going to do corporate management. That's kind of where I was wanting to go, kind of stoking that entrepreneurial business side of me that I enjoy a little bit. Not really sure what to do. I was dating this girl, not the lady over here. We won't talk much about this, but it wasn't right. Wasn't God-honoring is all I'm going to say about that. And I remember hitting that line smacking me in the face. The church in Rome, when Paul writes to them, he says, here's what you need to know. You're called to belong to Jesus Christ. There's a lot we don't know. There's a lot that your life could take you towards. There's a lot of different left and right turns off this path of life for you that you could take. But in the middle of it, you're called to belong to Jesus Christ. I knew that was true for me. And when I read those words, it reminded me of the faith of my childhood. It reminded me of my encounter at 5 years old and multiple encounters over the years. It reminded me that at this point, at this juncture, as I'm stepping out into adulthood, kind of really for the first time, you know, small, trepidatious steps, that I needed something to guide me. If not, I was going to respond in fear. I was going to respond with shallow dreams and shallow hopes. And I might get some of those. I was kind of successful in some of those shallow things. But they weren't satisfying. Even as a young man, there was always something more. And this line gripped my heart. When I read it, it was, Romans, Christians, you're called to belong to Christ. But on that day, as a boy in college, it was, Ben, you're called to belong to Christ. And that is the most important calling on your life. I'd like to tell you that ever since then, I've been faithful like Paul. That's not quite true at all. In fact, I've had to sometimes say with Paul, like he said in 1 Corinthians, I kind of am what I am. But God's grace has been sufficient for all that I am. In fact, if you're called to be with Christ, and you are, you can be what you are and who you are, and God's grace is sufficient. And what I have found is that because his grace is sufficient to meet me where I am and who I am and to take me where I'm to go, that grace holds so powerfully that even if I go left, get off the path, the grace of God allows me to come back and return to center. And if I go right, the grace of God calls me back and allows me to once again center on the fact that I've had an encounter with the resurrected Christ and I'm called to belong to him. So today, I've told you a couple of testimonies. I've told you the testimony of a handful of followers who, when they first took their first steps with the resurrected Christ, they were not full of faith and power. They were afraid, but they stayed with it. I told you the incredible story of the Apostle Paul, who is faithful, and he just stays with it, man. And I've told you the story about somebody so much less important than them, but a young man who needed a sense of direction and purpose and clarity in his life at a time when all the options were in front of me. There were so many options. I was overwhelmed with the options in front of me. And the resurrected Christ that I had met as a little boy grabbed hold of my heart in a fresh way and said, you're called to belong to me. So here's my Easter message to you. An encounter with the resurrected Christ changes everything. And you are called to belong to Christ. And his grace is sufficient for you to be who you have been and to pull you right back in line with him. So, there are some Christians today who probably need to be reminded that you're called to belong to Christ. I want to remind you that his grace is sufficient. The very grace that first saved you when you put your faith and trust in him, it will pull you from the right back to center. It'll pull you from the left back to center. As you're just being you and experiencing life and doing the thing, it'll pull you right back because you're called to belong to Christ. There's probably a handful of people in the room, the Bible would say if you're not a Christian, one of the labels it would use to put on you, and I know we don't like labels, but here's what the Bible says, that without Christ, then we are lost in our sin. So there's probably a handful of people who are lost in their sin, and the truth is you actually know that. You know you need a Savior. So I want to speak the words over you that Paul spoke to the Romans in chapter 1, verse 6. You are called to belong to Christ. I don't know everything else that's going to happen in your life, but I know that you're called to belong to Christ. That when Jesus was on the cross and he said it was finished, that his work is complete, that statement, it is finished, is big enough to encircle the globe and include you. His work in your life to restore your relationship with God, to wash away your sins and give you a new beginning, it was completed already at Calvary. And the proof that it worked is that there was an empty grave. The resurrection is proof that the death of Jesus satisfied God and restored our relationship. You're called to belong to Christ. The truth is there are probably a handful of lost people in this room who haven't put your faith and trust in Jesus, and you're not sure you need to. I want to speak to you the words that Paul spoke to the Roman church. You're called to belong to Christ. And an encounter with the resurrected Jesus can change everything. So which is it today? Are you a Christian that today that can celebrate in the fact, not that you're perfect, but that you are centered on him? That you're walking in some real way, not perfect, but some real way, as if you know you're called to belong to Christ. That he is not just the Savior of the world. Listen, he's actually your Lord. He's actually in charge of you. If so, in a moment when we stand to sing, I want you to sing as if he died just for you, because he did. Perhaps you're in the room and you're a Christian and you're a little left or a little right and you're just being you. Okay. I want to remind you what Paul said about him just being him. God's grace is sufficient. And you are called to belong to Christ. And maybe you're a lost in your sin person, and you know you're lost in your sin. Let me just speak his words over you. His grace is so powerful. It can wash away your sins, restore you to a right relationship with your Father, and you can begin to walk as if you belong and are called to belong to Jesus Christ. And even to the skeptic in the room. Yeah, you had no idea. Or you're listening online and you just somehow tuned in. I just want to tell you that the words that God preserved for us in this letter called Romans, it's for the Roman church, but it's for all of us. You are called to belong to Jesus Christ. And his grace is sufficient to pull you right in line so that you can begin to walk with him. So what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to pray. And I'm going to give you a chance to do a little bit of business with God. I'm going to ask, if you don't mind, for everybody to bow their head, close their eyes. You might hear a little bit of noise in the room. It's just the band getting ready to lead us in a worship song. But one more time, hear these words. You are called to belong to Christ. You are called to belong to Christ. No other claim on your life is as important. No other ambition on your life is as important. No failure in your life is bigger than the call on your life to belong to Christ. Nobody who has disappointed you is bigger than the call on your life to belong to Christ. You are called to belong to Christ. And in response to that, what do you need to say to our Heavenly Father? God, I'm sorry, I'm a sinner. Wash away my sins. I trust the work that you did on the cross and in your resurrection to save me. If that's your prayer, pray it. God, I've trusted you, but I'm a little left of center right now. I ask your grace. I know that I'm called to belong to Christ. And I commit this day to walk with you as the most important thing in my life. If that's your prayer, pray it. God, I'm not even sure really what I'm doing here and why I'm here, but if the resurrection is real, I'd like to meet the resurrected Jesus. If that's your prayer, pray it. Or God, I've been imperfect, but to the best I know how, you are the center of my life. I'm grateful that your grace is sufficient for me. Let me pray over us. Father, thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, the perfect sacrifice on the cross, laid in a borrowed tomb, who is not dead anymore. He is alive. He is alive. And I thank you that you have raised up men and women through the ages who knew with certainty that they belonged to you, and their stories, their testimonies, still speak loudly into our lives. Father, I pray that today in this space, your Spirit would do its work. That men and women would declare, Jesus, save me. That wayward Christians would declare, Jesus, I come back home. That faithful men and women would ponder what it means to truly belong to Jesus Christ. God, I'm grateful that you defeated death and hell, that you came out of that grave, that you are our victorious Savior, that you are risen and you reign. In this space, we celebrate not a dead God, not some form, not some structure. We celebrate a risen Christ, and we submit our lives to him. We belong to him. I pray all this in the name of Jesus, God's strong and holy Son. Amen. After service, my wife and I are going to be standing across the lobby. We don't have time to have a long conversation, but if you'd like to do that, we'll have our calendar out. I'd be glad to buy you coffee, and I'd be glad to hear your story and talk with you about the fact that you belong to Christ. It may take me a while to get to everybody, but it's my commitment to you. If you're our guest, thanks so much for being here. We like to end every service with a time of worship. So let's take a couple minutes together and worship the risen Christ.
Let's stand, let's worship. When we worship, we declare that he's good. We sing, Lord bless you. Come on, we sing. Thank you.
keep you, make his face shine upon you, be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. Oh, give us peace this morning.
Amen.
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 joining us for our Sunday service. We're going to close our service like we do every week and say our benediction prayer together. The words are going to be on the screen for you. Let's do it. May the words of my mouth and the thoughts of my heart be pleasing to you, O Lord, my rock and redeemer. Have a great Sunday and happy Easter.